before we even talk about your movie, this is the first time I've actually seen an Apple Watch
on somebody's
arm.
I make fun of him all the time for it.
I love it.
Needs that.
Does it come? Is it like a Sundance perk? Is that what?
No. It was. I was one of the people who pre-ordered it early on. I actually pre-ordered two and sold the other one for double on eBay to help pay for the watch that I got.
So independent filmmaking has taught you some lessons.
Benny used to do the most incredible scams. He used to load computers up with pirated. Really expensive programs, and then sell the computers for probably 7 times their value because you're getting $50,000 worth of programs. And to the point where someone contacted him, which was clearly someone with some authority.
they were just asking a lot of questions, and it was just like, I said, look.
It's a pretty good hustle.
I got them from work. I told you I got them from work. I could not, because they really wanted the CDs, and it was like, and you don't need the CDs. I know you don't need the CDs, but why do you want? I knew why he wanted them. I was like, but I got them from where I work. I said, I was very plain about that. I don't know.
But so is this indicative of the bonds of brotherhood? The disagreement of the watch for
probably
not really.
I don't
wear a watch just because.
I got him a nice watch once, and he's like, I don't wear watches. But
yeah, it was a really great watch. Yeah. It was this cool Russian watch, but I just don't. I don't know. I just hate time.
And is there a story about how you got the Russian watch?
Well, that I actually was collecting a lot of weird. I found out that there was a small section. I don't know of Russian population that would open the watches up and change the faces, like paint on them or add numbers where there were just dots.
Back in communist Russia where everyone got the same thing.
Yeah.
Getting frustrated and want to individualize it.
And it's like, we always have to look at our watches because the clock is so important, so it better look nice or it better be more functional. So they changed them. And I found one of that had like, it was like speech bubbles around all of the numbers. It was nice. But he doesn't wear a watch, so.
Yeah.
And so at what point did you guys decide working together would be a good idea?
I'd say it was imposed upon us by our father. He had a room it was actually more like a closet. It didn't have any windows. And often we didn't, you know, he didn't want to pay for a babysitter. So he would put us in this, it was kind of like a two closets joint. There was a door in the middle and he would put us in there. And all that was in there was this camera. And we had kept a lot of comics and stuff in there, and he would lock us in that closet for about 9 hours, 8 hours.
Yeah.
And then he would come home and unlock the closet. So we just kind of
he was a very heavy smoker at the time, and we made a anti-smoking commercial for him without telling him. We just took the camera, took the tape. And Josh played a rabid Knicks fan, and
this was the first movie you ever made, really.
Yes, he was like rooting for the Knicks, and he was having the time of his life, and then he lit up a cigarette, and then he just died.
Well, no, it was a fake documentary about him, there was a lot of mundane things you saw him doing, like cooking, you know,
and then he's like,
watching television.
At the Knicks game.
And then we simulated a Knicks game, and I was smoking throughout the video, and I'm like 8 years old. We're just stealing his cigarettes.
Forget that he dies at the Knicks game.
And then at the Knicks game, he smokes like a comically large cigarette that we made we wound a bunch of paper towels together. And like, it's a very strange movie because he's just rooting for the Knicks, completely happy, smoking the cigarette, and he dies.
Bam.
So and then we showed that to him.
Yes. I smoke now. No.
It was a warning to him, like
which I learned. You always want to be what you hate, which is strange when you're that age. But our dad was really. He spent one of his bonuses on a video camera in 1988, and he had these aspirations of he always wanted to be a filmmaker. So he would film us all the time, and incite drama, to kind of create more interesting, product. He wanted to have great movies, and he actually loved great films. And instead of teaching us a lesson, he would show us a movie. So we had this crazy broken family, and it was actually much more kind of messed up and complicated than Kramer versus Kramer. But instead of, we had to go see our mom after she got out, she was in the hospital for a while, whatever.
She was regaining custody from him.
Instead of like, we had all these questions, he's like, just watch this movie instead. And we put on Kramer versus Kramer.
He said, and I'm Dustin Hoffman and your mother's
Meryl Streep. Yeah.
He said that.
And we would, so I don't know, we had a very strange relationship with movies. And on top of that, when you're 8 years old and you're sitting there and you're like separating, you know, the things in your room that you want to spend time with and things you don't want to spend time with, like, you know, certain comics or cards or whatever, and you're just in the room alone and you think that you're having this quiet moment to yourself and you look in the corner of your eyes and you realize someone's been filming you from the archway of the door surreptitiously. And you look, and the camera's not on you. It's actually aimed down on your hand. And later when you see the footage, you realize he zoomed in really tightly on the mannerism of the way the hand is discarding the things that we didn't want. So as an 8-year-old kid, 10-year-old kid, whatever, you know, especially as, you know, anyone born post, you know, 1984, really, to be, you know, symbolic with things, which is the year I was born. You know, you see the camera, so I'm saying 84 because when video became more prevalent, the camera became this thing that meant worthy of document, worthy of documentation. If you're going to take a picture of something, you're going to film it, it means it needs to live on forever. So as this little kid, I'm not saying I was thinking about all this stuff as a kid, but in hindsight, I'm realizing where all this crap came from. You know, you're sitting there thinking like, okay, why is he filming me doing what I'm doing right now? What is so important about this moment? And I don't know, I think that that definitely ingrained this kind of concept of like, you know, sensationalizing reality and focusing on the small. Yeah, I mean, as we move on as filmmakers, I kind of want to get bigger and bigger. But yeah, I mean, we would go every year, he would like, no matter what, we would always go to Killington, Vermont, and we would stay at the Happy Bear Motel, all of us, me, Benny, and sometimes his girlfriend. It was like, kind of horrific trip, but he would also, there was a video store rental place there, and he would always pick the scariest, most secluded movie. The Shining was the first thing.
He did The Shining specifically because he knew there was a big blizzard coming in, and we were going to have the snow up to the windows. He's like, I got the perfect movie for what they're going to wake up to.
A bit of a literalist, too.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, he literally, if I wouldn't eat, he had a stack of Daily News papers in his closet. And if we didn't finish our Lucky Charms for breakfast, he would yell in his broken English or whatever. He would yell, and then he would go to the closet and pull out, you know, one of six Daily News things, and he would pull out the Somalian little hand, and he's like, do you want your hand to look like this? There are kids out there who can't have normal-sized hands.
No, they would kill for that Lucky Charm.
That fake marshmallow that you want to flush down the toilet. Yeah. And, you know, side note, I used to use the milk from Lucky Charms to gel my hair. But I remember when we used to play kind of near one of our windows. We only lived on like the fourth floor.
He's very literal, but he pulled
out the issue, Daily News issue, about Eric Clapton's son falling out of the window and dying. He goes, you want to fall out the window and die? So
now, yeah.
He's dramatic. I remember what I'm getting is we went to Killington one year, and we actually were with my buddy Greg. You remember Greg came up with us? And we were in this little gondola, and our dad's filming, right? And
he specifically brings up something that caused a fight the night earlier that he didn't film. Yeah. He brings it up again.
Because he wants to get it on camera. And it gets to the point. Because I was a snowboarder, Benny was a skier. It gets to the point where Benny's jabbing my face with his ski pole. And all you can hear in the video is this laughter. And at one point he pans to my friend Greg, who was like, I was like 13 at the time, 14 or something. My friend Greg's like this. Oh, God. Please stop. What's going on? Why are you filming me? Why aren't you stopping your sons from killing each other?
It's the same thing where it was like literally he would ski. He was like, we're going to go the perfect trail, double black diamond. All right, skier, but I'm not ready for this. And he says, wait here, puts me at the top, and he skis all the way down to the bottom, gets the camera out, and he goes, go! And he knows that I'm not going to be able to handle it. And the first turn I make, I slip, and skis fly off. There's snow everywhere. And I'm sliding down the mountain at like 80 miles
right per hour. Past him. He doesn't even get in front.
And so then he, and then I stop. Like, luckily I didn't hit a tree, but I stop and I get up and the entire chairlift is clapping because I'm alive. And he's just like, that was amazing. Screaming, like, how do you feel? How do you feel? And I'm just like, I could repeat it, but it was very violent. And then right after that, we met up with Josh, who he just decided he's not snowboarding fast enough for me, so we're going to go along without him. So Josh is now in the middle of the slope
by myself.
At like.
And I remember I had gloves, I had mittens on, and I just see him, and I held the finger up in the mittens, but it just looked like a mitten. And I was just going like this, so it was just like that, right? And he goes, "Don't give me the finger." And I said, "Who are you? You're my father." Definitely not my father.
Yeah, so, all one trip. But
yeah, that was one trip down the mountain, actually.
It sounds like quite a childhood.
Yeah, it was quite, I mean, we're not even talking about the mother side of things, which is honestly like so... At one point, it was so dark that I don't even have any memory of it. Mm. So, our parents were very young when they had us. And, you know, they weren't artists by any degree. So, like, it was, I don't know, they just kind of, like, grew, you know, our dad kind of was in charge of us for a while. And then our dad had no fight when she came back, when she got, you know, mentally ready, you know. Mm. And she came back for custody, and he just had, I just remember... these little mini cassettes that reporters sometimes use. And I just remember finding my dad's trove of recorded conversations because he was like his own lawyer.
Yeah, they were just so damning to him. Like,
and then I'll never forget the most effective thing that ever went is like years later after he like moved, he married an Israeli woman and was living there and he had a kid with her. We found that out after the kid was born. And I remember going and staying, like meeting her in Israel and like, you know, I don't really dig some, Israel's a beautiful place, but I don't really, whatever, I never really got into the vibe there. So I was just like kind of depressed and I was there alone. I remember doing graffiti, being like weird, like I'm gonna go do some graffiti in like Tel Aviv. So I was like on my, but so, and I was so jet lagged, and one night I was like on his computer and I just found he kept like a really, really extensive diary on a computer. Of going through basically it started at the beginning of the custody battle and ended, went all the way up to the future, to the present. And I remember crying really hard and just realizing like, I don't know, our dad was always very human to us, but it was this moment where I realized like, I don't know, whatever, we don't have to go into that.
So does that all lead to art? Does it lead to just experimenting? What is
it? I think, yeah, if art is, expression, yeah, of course. You know, I mean, it could have led to drugs very easily. We had that around us as kids, but it, you know, and it almost did for me at one point. But you know, I was able to kind of overcome that and realize that my drug can be drama, and the greatest form of drama comes in the form of movie making, because time is so condensed and you can mess around with it. And expression. Is something that can really be of value. So yeah,
it's like a wound, you know. That's I think the Greek thing, or so. There's like you inspecting the wound or looking at it. You need to be.
Who was it that said? Because I was saying like I never really got into like interested in like psychiatry and that be like that because I was really.
Oh, that we were. It was during an interview once, but. It's oh, like, okay. It's funny because I think it's very important.
I really look to making the movies as like a way of trying to understand. You know, but what's going on. And I feel like if I were to go into the brain and like separate it and like dig down to these problems, maybe I wouldn't have the expression. I don't know.
And I kind of feel it's important to have that process, you know, to go through that process of trying to understand yourself in a weird way. So, but I don't know, that kind of difference is what allows us to like work together and make things deeper or, yeah.
So when you're, is this analysis of what you're doing after you made the movie, looking back at what you did, or is it process, or is it...
Which movie? Just in general?
In general, in the work you guys are doing together.
I mean, I always, it's kind of like a, the writing process is pretty conscious, and then you enter this kind of like war, which is making a movie that nobody wants to have made. And then that's kind of like a subconscious process where you're just kind of like, you know, yes, you're instinctively acting and you have all these notes from like your preparation, but you're really just kind of like moving along and you just want it to be over. And then you have this process of the editing, and then you have, when it's a final piece, you get to look at it. And then that, and I usually have, I don't know how interesting this is. Is this interesting?
Yeah.
And I don't know, I, uh, I just like to, I usually like to sit, it's probably like a month or two after or throughout the edits, watch chunks of the movie. And that's when I start, you know, that's when I start to really understand why these decisions were made and understand where they're coming from within me. And I learn stuff about, you know, about the way I think and feel, I guess.
And for you, or you?
Well, yeah.
He doesn't have a brain.
Yeah, no, I don't. It's literally, that's what it kind of feels like when you're making a movie, is you kind of just shut it and then you move forward, you know, you're kind of, but yeah, I don't know. I don't really, I like editing as a part of it, the process. And I don't know, there's something about the split second decision making, you know, that you're kind of just moving with it. But I don't know. Yeah. I think when we're making the actual film, it's kind of this, like, it's really like this give and take that we're doing that really. Sometimes it feels like tag team wrestling, you know. I don't know. It's like,
well, definitely with the press thing, with the press and like the, you know, the necessity of kind of rolling the movie out.
I just remember there were some days on set where it was just
the,
like,
fact that there's two of us makes it kind of easy, you know.
It's
one of us can, I don't know. It's just,
but even on set, there were
certain
not,
filmmaker friends of ours are very jealous that we have a partner who's able to sometimes, like, oh, Josh couldn't make it today, so I'm here.
Right.
But
yeah, yeah. There was one time, I forget what it was.
What was that?
They said we couldn't figure. They could not figure out the difference between our voices, and it was impossible. And we said, "It's fine. We'll speak as one. Just say, quote us as one, as the
brothers." You mean, so somebody was typing you on audio? And
yeah, they were just saying, "I'm sorry, I can't. It's impossible for me to figure it out." And we said, "That's fine. Just do it as a general quote." You know.
We speak for one. So I mean, is it? Is it I don't know if there's an answer to the question. Is it a symbiotic thing? Is it switching off? Is it that tag team where?
Yeah, I mean, look, let's take an anecdote and choose it as kind of a microcosm of how we work. So on the last movie that we did, we intuitively developed a new system of directing, which was, you know, the way we normally direct is we don't like to bark, both of us bark orders at an actor. Mm-hmm. Seldomly we do, but, you know, On Heaven Knows What, we just kind of found ourselves, you know, I would mostly be working with the cameras and Benny ran sound. And because I had this previous relationship with many of the people in the movie, I, you know, was the one who talked and delineated the direction. And you know, I was the dialogue. Mm-hmm. And because Benny was running sound, everyone was wearing a lav mic and I had the wireless monitoring of what he could hear.
But so, only he could only hear the boom. So I had a boom mic. But right. So I knew that I could speak into that boom mic and only he would hear it.
So he would hear me giving direction. And that's how he would, and he would hear our conversation and hear what they were saying. And then he would chime in with his thoughts and additions for direction by just telling me them. And then I could seamlessly work them into my direction. So from them, they're only hearing one voice, but they don't realize that it's coming from two people.
And I
don't even feel like we should talk about that too much, because then people are going to be like, who's saying that?
Yeah, but for the most part, we speak about what the war plan before, right. And it's like, okay, this is how we're comfortable attacking the next day, or, you know, attacking this. So if somebody speaks, we're usually on the same page, and if not, we go behind where nobody can see usually. Sometimes the bubble's over it and they see, but...
So was it different working with a lead actress who was also your...
I'm messing with your microphone here.
I thought you were going to striptease for you.
No, it's just... Is that better? It's good?
Right. So was it different working with an actress who really was in many ways her story and her co-writing and her acting and everything else?
Yes and no. I mean,
once it got to the process of actually making the film, she kind of submitted to the process of this greater thing that made it a lot easier. You know, it wasn't like she had, she didn't take ownership over that
right.
in that way. She knew that there was going to be another step, another level that we all had to hit. So
she gave that up.
Well, we did do this documentary beforehand, which we spent a better part of 4 years following this basketball player around, and or he's no longer a basketball player. And that, you know, that was a biography. You know, we were telling someone else's story, but it was in the form of documentary, and it wasn't really our story at first, and there's a lot of reasons why it wasn't. You couldn't compare it to Heaven Knows What. And Heaven Knows What, I really believe, is kind of like I don't know, this new type of movie, you know, not to like sound arrogant, but it really, it felt like a new type of movie for us because it's not a fiction, because it is, it's nonfiction, but it's nonfiction drama, and it's a psychodrama because we're asking this person to kind of recreate feelings, and not even the, not when her, in her recreations, we're asking her to kind of access a greater truth, which isn't actually the way things happened. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of for the sake of drama, and like we're really demanding performances, and we're mixing first time actors and veteran actors and professionals and non-professionals, so rappers and what's that, whatever, etc., etc., and like the real street itself. But I don't know. I think that the in the very beginning, you know, I'd say the first week of filming, I'd say that the Ari was often asking, you know, was often being the authority that we wanted her to be, which was like, it didn't happen this way, it happened that way. And then when we were doing all of our pre-production, our prep and everything, mm-hmm. and the writing and the script, et cetera, you know, and casting, we would always run everything by her because, you know, she needed to be comfortable within, you know, the context of the scenes and the drama. And sometimes she would say, like, well, it actually didn't happen this way, and I think that this thing would be, you know, X, Y, and Z. And then that's when we would have to kind of, like, basically say to her, in order to tell, like, the greater truth, you have to lie a little bit. So that, like, if we stuck to, like, no one wants to watch C-SPAN, and that's the closest thing to a real documentary that exists. Right. You know, like, there's no feeling there, and we wanted to kind of get at the feeling. So.
So was this mixture of people and the idea of that completely conceptual? Was it circumstance? Was it okay?
I mean, film is a very is a very conceptual art form. It's, I mean, if you think about what you're doing, you're recreating life, and you're and the whole concept of time in a movie is insane. Like, you can span 3,000 years if you want. Like our buddy Ronnie, who co-wrote the movie with, and Benny edited the movie with. He has this real joke. He's like, all right, here's something to do in Hollywood. Next time you go in for a pitch, you walk in and you say, the year is 9 billion. And you just start that way and like see what they say. And then if they don't say anything immediately, you know that they're probably not going to listen to you at all. And if they laugh and they get that this is a joke, but like, yeah, the year is 9 billion. I really like that. So, yeah, movies are conceptual, but this nothing new to us. We love working with first-time actors and I think people who have no baggage.
Yeah, and I think in this case, circumstance is actually an interesting word because I hadn't occurred to me. And this, it was kind of like, it almost, because we were always saying it wasn't the decision to cast her, you know, or decision this, but it only made sense. You know, it was the only way that this movie made sense was she was going to play the role. And these people in her life were going to play these roles, you know? That was like kind of, it just happened. I don't know.
What was that?
Was there any question about whether she could carry a movie for you guys? Or was that
Well, that was when I first met her on, you know, on the street. I didn't know anything about her lifestyle or what have you. I thought she was just kind of this Diamond District girl. And the thing I responded to was her stardom. So it wasn't, you know, did I think she could carry a movie? That was the reason why I stopped her. I was like, she could carry, you know, a lifetime. Mm-hmm. So.
And did it, was it ever, was this mixture of things and the style of making the movie and everything else ever problematic? Or
yeah, of course.
Yes. But in a way that wasn't just the way you make a movie and that it's hard and you have to answer 7,000 questions a day?
Yes. Yeah.
The whole process of making this film was harder and more difficult than any other film that we made in different way for different reasons because of that, you know. So it's
I recently went onto a friend's movie set and it was just so incredible to like see how easy it is, mm-hmm. how easy it can be, you know. Like, oh yeah, you and just have, and it's everyone's waiting around and you do this and
it's like, yeah, the main, like, it's not that every movie has to be a complete crazy madness. In this case, it actually helped that it was that you feel that energy, but we do have a general rule that, like, look, if you're going to be there, you have to be doing something. You know, right. There's always got to be. So that means that there's a lot of times where there sometimes is like one or two or three less people than you actually need.
I think that Caleb, for example, you know, who's coming from, you know, yes, he's done some smaller art films, you know, like Antiviral and, you know, you could say that Byzantium wasn't, the Borman film, I guess, was small overnight. But like, you know, he had Byzantium and X-Men and Contraband. His first movie ever was a Coen Brothers film. I mean, he's coming from, you know, the system. And I think, I mean, he never not once even said, like, oh, this is so different from, because he's a smart person. He doesn't think like that. But in hindsight, you know, when I was talking to him, he just, you know, he said it was very refreshing to him to kind of come on to a movie and not be reminded that it's a movie at all times. You know what I mean? And I think that for us, that was, you know, like I had this jacket that I wore throughout the production, and by the end it looked like something you find behind a dryer in a laundromat. And I was just pretty, we were just a ratty crew, and we really were of the street, and I even knew some of the cops from the 20th precinct who constantly for some reason were tailing us. So I don't know, it's just, there was something, I don't know, I look at movies always as kind of a conceptual form of architecture. And, you know, when you build a building, you arrive on the site, you look at the land, how deep can I build, how high can I build, what are the neighboring buildings, if there are any buildings, is it a city, is it a house, is it, what's the purpose? Mm-hmm. And you build vertically. There's always like systems and codes to architecture. And I think that with this movie specifically, we were at most in sync with this kind of vertical concept of you start with your core, your concept, your idea, and then everything that grows out of it is referring to its initial conceit. So concept. So like if you were to walk on set, you'd be able to, just by eating the trail mix that our AD made for everybody, you know, you would be in a weird way understanding, knowing what the movie would look and feel like. And I don't say that like, I mean that. I'm not saying it to for any other reason, but because I mean it. So that, like, you know, when you see the movie, every piece of music, every lens that we used, you know, it all was kind of it all came from really that not that first time I met her, but it came from that second meeting, from when I really met her.
It's funny you mentioned the trail mix, because
What was that?
No, everybody was actually attuned to the changes of the ingredients, like very, very slight changes, because it was just like little bags of this, but it was very.
David made a nice trail mix, and this was his first time he ever made a movie.
But it was like every time he'd add something new, and everybody would notice that there was something new. It was very.
Oh, well, thanks.
Could you have made the movie a more traditional way?
I don't know. I think about that. I think that there is. I think that we would have figured it out. I don't think that I want to say no, just because, again,
it would have been a different movie.
Architecturally, we built this movie with the tools that we needed, and I think that if we had bigger tools or more people, I think that I don't know. I just don't know what that would have done to the performances. Yeah. I don't know what that would have done to the mindset of the crew. Our crew is very small. I don't know what that would have done. Definitely wouldn't have done to the street. Like, we couldn't have closed the streets down, because we needed that street life.
Like, there's little things. Like, we would have had the guy more on fire. Or, you know, we would have had another take.
We would have had, if we had more money, we would have had a helicopter shot at the end. Like, I know that. We really wanted to do that, and we just couldn't afford it. And that's, you know, and I hate to say that, because you never want to say money is the reason why you can't do something. Because that's not true. You should always be able to figure out a way to do it. And in the end, we get the concept that we wanted to have. We wanted to, like, have a helicopter shot that's on the Dunkin' Donuts at the end of the movie. Right. And it starts in tight, and then it pulls out, and then it drifts over Manhattan, you know, and the credits are over the city. Mm-hmm. I wanted to do that. And, like, we thought about all the ways we could do it with a drone, and we talked to some helicopter companies. And by the time we actually came up with that idea, we were so not over budget, but out of money at least. So, you know, it was just like either we can get the Tomita score or we do the helicopter shot. So, and that was what my producer said to me, Oscar. I was like, no chance for both.
Are you guys now old enough in this venture that the idea of using a drone to get a shot is like what the kids are doing?
Yeah, I saw a movie that a friend made called The Wonderful Cloud, that he used a drone in it, but the whole aesthetic of his movie fit in with, like, cutting to a drone all of a sudden. Mm-hmm. Where, and we had
Black Balloon.
We tried to do stuff in Black Balloon, but like I'm so believe in like this kind of
the quality. The whole movie would need to be shot on drone.
If we could, but I talked to a drone company that was able to mount our cameras. So if we could mount our cameras with our filtration and our lenses, then yes, I could see it working. But, you know, we couldn't, the amount of money that you, those drones are really expensive and you can't even fly them over New York City. So it would have been like we have to ask somebody to do, you know, something, you know, usually the more illegal something is, the more money they want. Right. So like at that point, we would have just gotten a helicopter. Which I prefer anyway.
It sounds like your brother would be up for pretty much anything.
Benny?
Your earlier conversation.
Oh, me?
Yeah.
Oh, what do you mean?
Well, you know, you're making a computer.
Oh, no. Please. I didn't do that. You made that up.
I made it up, yeah.
You've retired from a life of crime to become a serious filmmaker.
Never.
On the narrow now.
I got to have the most powerful computer to edit. That's all.
That's completely understandable. So you met this young lady. Is the story literal in terms of her life, in terms of this, or did you pick a theme, an idea?
Yeah, Ronnie and I, when we were reading all these pages, we scoured. Basically, we would read everything and all the stuff where we have this, you know, way of interacting with each other, where we say it moved. We're referring to our, you know, to our dicks, and you know, we don't. It actually is not moving, but it's actually a mental dick. The mental dicks.
The mental dick. Moves.
Yeah, the mental dick moves.
The blood went to the
and,
mental dick.
And it's like this idea that there's a scratch that you want to itch, and that like it's a very peculiar scratch. For whatever reason, whenever it moves, when we were writing, we would jot down in the liner notes, it moved, and at the end we would kind of obviously. Those are the things you kind of just, you know, focus on, like when you squint your eyes at all of the writing. But while we were reading, we were always looking for an entry point. And then once we found the time period that we wanted to focus on, because her book spans about 6 years, probably. And we wanted to focus on, we thought about earlier years, but then we ended up focusing naturally on the last 6 months of her life. And then what we did with those 6 months is we compressed and condensed characters, compressed and condensed time. We moved things around, and it's presented as linear. You know, I mean, if you actually look at the amount of time that happens in the movie, it's about 2.5 weeks because she's in. Anyone who's been to a psych ward knows after an attempted suicide, you have to do a minimum week.
Right.
Or it's actually I think 7 days. 7 days.
Yeah.
7 days. So then. So you can say it's maybe 10 to 11 days in New York, and we just kind of took a lot and moved things around for the sake of, you know, dramatic arc. And also when you were reading the pages...
Hot two weeks.
Yeah. When you were reading the page, you know, you would do this thing as a reader once you got accustomed to the world that Ari was writing about. Your eyes would naturally kind of scan forward and see if you're going to come across an Ilya paragraph. And because he became this kind of this desire, like you always wanted to see what he was going to do next.
You knew that if you saw him come if you up knew the story, if you, something was going
to
happen.
Yes. Like, so it became this kind of like antidote to kind of the junky existentialism that was in this world. So Ilya was like this antidote, this dramatic antidote to this life of like aimlessness.
Rambling,
in a way.
Yeah.
So
he's
and
a driver.
And I think that you can really feel that in the movie, that whenever he shows up in the movie, it kind of brings back the drama. You know, what is this movie about? It's about, you know, a young girl and her dangerous love for a pretty darkly romantic guy. And that romance happens to be stronger and more detrimental than the romance to dope. So it's like choosing what, you know, which danger do you want to indulge
in? Also both. It's like it's dope and the thing mixed together as opposed to just one, you know, so it's doubly as insane.
And I'm convinced that theater smart ones kill cell phone service. So that experience of like going into a dark room and turning off, even though I know more and more people don't and they keep their phones on and they text during it, whatever. I don't care if people talk or anything, but for me, just the idea of going into a dark room and watch, looking at a 70-foot screen is cool.
No,
and I think that will never die. But then again, I'm not opposed.
People thought it was going to die. And what?
It's never going to die. It's never going to die. It's too much of a spectacle.
It's come back.
We love looking at ourselves.
And we love being in a group and having that feeling. And then it's like there was a moment where everybody's, oh, it's going to all go to streaming. It's going to all do this. Theaters are going to die, all this. But it didn't.